Ooh, that's even better. So, before we start, I want to pray. Dear Jesus, thank you so much. Thank you so much for who you are and for those promises that you do give us. And God, I just pray right now, Lord, as we look through your word, God, that we are able to seat those promises in our heart. And we love you, and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're on this series called Unfulfilled Promises. And I think it's unfulfilled is because God promised things to us, but so many times I think we miss to take a hold of those promises. Last week, Aaron, he talked about rest. And, you know, rest is one of those weird things, right? Because we want rest, but then when we get it, what do we normally do? I just zone out, right? I'm not in that place where I'm like, oh, I feel rested, right? We just went on vacation. We went on a cruise. I love cruises. They're great. Greatest things on earth. Everybody came, when I came back, they're like, you don't look tan. And I say, no, I don't go out in the sunlight at all. I just stay at the buffet and I eat. So, but, you know, when I came back, it was one of those things where when I went back into my normal routine of, you know, with my kids and my job and those things like that, it was like, man, dude, did I even rest during that time? Like, what was that really look like? You know, and Aaron last week, he really talked about how we fulfill that promise that God gave us of rest. And so this week, we're looking at another promise that God has given us. So, I occasionally like going to the gym. Anybody like going to the gym? Yeah. So have you guys ever been there? And I know for males, this is even more, right? I go to the gym. I go to the weights. They're laid out there, and I look around, and I pick up a weight, and I put it back down because that's too heavy. And then I pick up another weight. Oh, that's still too heavy. And I pick up another weight, and I start lifting. I'm like, yeah, I feel good. I feel good. And then what happens, right? One of those freaks of nature, the guy who looks like Arnold Schwarzenegger on more steroids, comes over and it stands like right next to you, right? And then you're lifting this little itty-bitty weight and like, he's like grabbing something that weighs more than me and is not even struggling. And then what happens inside me, right? I'm like, oh, God, I'm not going to stand next to this guy. So then I act like I need to get water and then I go cry in the locker room and then I go home, right? And it's one of those things where, you know, even for me, you know, in those type of situations, that weakness is looked down upon, right? Your brokenness is one of those things that is looked down upon, right? Have you ever been to, like, a party? This was me in, like, high school. I'd go to, like, you know, a function, and I'd be the guy standing in the corner, and you see that really popular person really talking it up and engaging everything, and then you're like, okay, I'm gonna go over it. I like artichoke dip. And then everybody walks away, and you're like, oh, why did I do that again? And then you go back to your corner. So the idea of weakness, it's almost like this thing that when we look upon it, it's unnatural. It's not praised, right? We value strength and confidence. That is, in our culture today, that is what we value, right? It's, are you strong? Are you, you know, mentally strong, emotionally strong? Are you confident in those type of things, right? Even when tragedy hits, you know, in our lives, it's, you know, one of those things is, you know, are you holding up, right? How are you being strong in these type of things? And we fight to not show weakness, right? That, I think, in especially in our culture, we really fight not to show weakness. I'm not going to show that emotional strain. So where I work in the jail, you know, it's one of those things, right? Like, you don't cry in jail. That's a weakness, right? And it's one of those things where I think even that mentality of how we pursue life is in that, right? We don't want to show our brokenness. We don't want to show our weakness. But one of God's unfulfilled promises, is that somebody's phone? Oh, okay, good. No. Weakness. It's my ADD. I'm like, oh, phone. one of God's unfulfilled promises is his strength. His strength. Not our strength. But most of the time, I always view, you know, in my life, I look at my brokenness, I look at my failures, and I judge myself on those things. And most of the time, when I do that, it grabs me to the core, where then I start to define myself with those weaknesses. I am worthless. I am a failure. I am junk. And I think so many times in our lives, if we really step back, that is what that voice in the back of our head starts telling us, right? Right when I start stepping out, you know, and start doing things, maybe for God, maybe, you know, in my job and those things like that, and that little voice says, you're a failure. You're weak. And so this is where God's promise steps in. God's promise is to say, how do I allow my strength in your life? So I found this cool picture. There's this art form, and I'm going to botch the name of this art form. It's kintsugi, and that's one I'm not even going to pronounce. But it means to repair with gold, right? And it's the most fascinating style. So it's a Japanese art form, and it actually derived from this one emperor. He broke his favorite teacup. And this emperor, instead of throwing this teacup away, he said, I need to get this fixed. It's my favorite teacup, right? And so instead of just throwing out, what they did is they molded it back together with gold. And I think so many times, this is a great representation of what God wants to do with us, right? So this idea of this pottery, it's not to hide the flaws. It's to show the beauty of the brokenness. The artists, when they put these things back together, it's to highlight the cracks, to highlight the history, to highlight the memory of this pottery. And I always think, you know, when I was a kid, man, I remember breaking stuff in my house, and I try to put it back together, right? My mom was like, oh, no, right? And it doesn't really last too long. And so many times in my life, when I feel broken, I try to put myself back together. Right? And my glue is not good. It's not good at all. So I started putting things back together, and it might last for a little bit. And then when I start putting pressure on it, it all crumbles. And I feel like that's so much of my life, right? I'm broken, and I try to put myself back together, and it looks all right on the surface, but when things really happen, it just shatters again. And see, what God wants to do in our lives, that promise, he says, no, I'm not just going to throw you out. You're not worthless. You're broken. Yeah. But you're not worthless. In fact, I am going to make you something even more precious, even more amazing, even more artful and beautiful than you could even imagine. And we're going to see that brokenness. But we're also going to see where God put these things together with his glory. And so Paul, in his second letter to the Corinth church, he really writes this, right? He's struggling with all this stuff in this. And 2 Corinthians is a phenomenal book because it really talks about all the kind of hardships and all the stuff he's going through. But towards the end of the chapter, he actually starts talking about, you know, how he had this great vision, right? Is how he came to know God. And, you know, I mean, he's riding on a mule or walking on the street to Damascus, and all of a sudden, God shows up, and it's this massive vision. Right? And so it's this point where all of a sudden he was like, man, this is great. God, Jesus came right to me. But he writes this because then something happened afterwards. Right? So in 2 Corinthians, you can look it up on the board or in a Bible or on your phones or just listen. He says this. He says this in 2 Corinthians 12:7-10. He says, so to keep me from being conceited because of my surpassing greatness of the revelation. Right? I love that right there. Right? Surpassing greatness. But I was on the path of being conceited. A thorn was given to me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with my weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. I think so many times when I read this, I read it in the kind of like, oh, yes, when I am weak, I am strong. And I think most of the time what happens in this, see, Paul was going through stuff, and there's a lot of debate, theological debate out there, of this, the thorn in Paul's flesh. And the reality is, I don't know if it really matters. Because we all have those things in our lives, right? Those little thorns. I remember going hiking, and you ever, what are those, goat heads? You ever get those, right? And they get stuck in you, and you just want it out, and it just irritates the skin like there's no other, and you're like, oh, this hurts so bad, right? And so many times a thorn is those irritations in our lives, those weaknesses, the brokenness that we're struggling with. And here Paul is, he's like, you know what, I had this amazing moment, and I could have been conceited. I could have just been so proud of myself. I could have been looking down at everybody else, but you know what, there was this thorn that's put in my side. And so many times, you know, I've heard massive talks on this where, you know, God's going to do this. Well, you know, honestly, I think it's really where God says, hey, this is where you're broken. This is your brokenness. Before this, Paul could have put himself back together and made him look so good on the outside, but deep down inside, he was broken. And God's like, hey, there's something up with this. And it says, a messenger of Satan to harass me. And I like that because so many times I think it's that little voice. When I start doing something and I feel embarrassed or I feel I'm not good enough or I... You know, that little voice that says, you're worthless, you're not good, you're never going to achieve anything. That's that message. And I get that all the time. Every time I step into something new or something where I really feel like God is really pushing me into, what's the first thing that happens? Ah, no, not going to happen. No, I'm not good enough. Oh, look at me, I'm broken. There's no way I'm going to be able to do that. And Paul, in this moment, what I love about it is he recognized it. He prayed for it. And not just prayed for it, he pleaded with God to take this away. I think in my life, there's so many things where I'm like, God, you have to fix this. God, you have to fix this. But what happens is so many times I think we get defined by our weakness. You are not defined by your brokenness or your weakness. Let me say again. You are not defined by your brokenness or your weakness. You're defined by who God is making you to be. So in my work, so many times I work with people who that is their definition of themselves. They're broken. They're an addict. They're a convict. They're never going to achieve anything. So many times I meet with them, and then they get out, and they're all happy, and then what happens? They come back to jail, and then they relive this thing again. When they get out, and I've talked to so many people who are like, well, I got out, and everywhere I went, I was just, this is who I am, and I'm this, I'm an addict, and I can't ever break that, and those type of things like that. And I think so many times in my life, when I stop and really look at the things that hold me back, it's those things that I allow to define myself because I feed into it. I may be praying, God, you got to take this away from me. God, you got to take this away from me. And there's moments in my life, I remember one moment in my life, I was praying so hard for God to fix my situation. And it didn't. And it wrecked me. And all of a sudden, I'm like, man, you know, instead of looking at the promise of God gave me to not just throw me out or to get rid of the situation, he said, no, I'm going to be there with you in it. In fact, I'm going to restore you through this. I'm going to restore you. I'm going to make you something more beautiful. I'm going to make you something more profound. I'm going to challenge that definition of yourself. God wants to do that. God wants to restore who you are. He's not, the reality is he's not going to get rid of those things that happen in our life. So many things I work with clients is through trauma, right? There's a lot of trauma that goes on, and, you know, people just want that to go away. And the reality is it won't. But the beauty of this promise that God says is, my grace is sufficient for you. The idea of grace, that grace where nothing we could do to achieve it. We can't reach out for his grace. He gives it freely to us. He says, my power is made perfect in your weakness. And this is where Paul says, okay, I'm going to hold on to that. I'm going to know I'm broken. I know that I have this thorn, this irritant in my side. And instead of running from it or defining myself by it, I'm going to define myself on how Christ has changed me through this. And when we start looking at it that way, that's when Paul says, you know what? I'm going to boast all the more. He said, I'm not going to identify by my weakness. I'm going to boast because of my weakness that God is greater than anything in there. That he provides this strength when I don't have strength. And I don't think Paul was doing that humble brag, right? Where you're like, I got 3 hours of sleep, but I still look good. No, it's not the humble brag. We're like, look at my weaknesses, right? Paul's not making himself the martyr to his weakness. I think when I meet with my clients, sometimes we fall into that martyrdom, right? This is who I am. I'm broken. Accept me the way I am. I want to accept you. God's going to accept you, but God doesn't want to just stop there. God doesn't want to just let you just be broken. God doesn't want you just to be in that weakness. God wants to reform you through those weaknesses so that we know through everything that God's strength is that culminating factor, that thing that binds us back together. Paul, in the book of 2 Corinthians, he goes on. I mean, what I love about this is so many times Paul, he's like, hey, you know what? This is where we're at. He's not shying away from the struggles we're in. In fact, in 2 Corinthians 4, 8 through 10, he says, we are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. I love that there because he looks at the reality of it. I think in our lives, there's so many things where we're struggling with things, and he says, yeah, there is going to be a struggle, but we're not defeated because of who Jesus is. He says, we always carry around in our bodies the death of Jesus so that the life of Jesus may be revealed in our bodies. It's like that art. The life of Jesus, that restoration life of Jesus, where it's beautiful. And he didn't make a mistake. He didn't fail when things were going on in our lives. That's just part of our fallen nature. But he's like, you know what? I'm not going to end there. I'm going to show you and show others who I am. That beauty, that gold inlay, that even through your brokenness, you're even more beautiful. And that we're not going to stop there, but that my strength is more powerful than anything else. It's kind of like when I go back to the gym and that freak of nature is lifting weights and they need a spot. Like, yeah, I know. My power is made perfect in your weakness. Right? Paul goes on, I don't have this up on the board, but before, when I was praying this morning, I was reading this, and it's also in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. It's verse 16. He says, therefore, do not lose heart. Though we're outwardly wasting away, yet innerly we're being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that outweighs all of them. And I think when I step back and I start looking at God's promise of this restoration, the thing that holds me back from being restored from God is myself. I define myself by my brokenness. I define myself by all those other things. Instead of defining myself by the grace of God, by what God can do in my life. And I think that's where all of a sudden I have to be diligent in that. God's like, no, listen, Mark, I'm restoring you. I'm restoring you for a purpose. I'm restoring you because you have value. You have something that no one else has. In fact, I want to make you so beautiful that you show others on how I can restore them. One of those things with the restoration of God is he wants to restore us so that we can bring that to others. It's like the bowl in China shop. He wants to fix everything in there. But so many times I get so stuck on myself that, oh, I'm not beautiful enough. I'm not good enough. I'm weak. He's like, no. I'm going to bind all that brokenness together and make something beautiful out of it. You guys can stand with me. Have the band come back up. God's unfulfilled promises. I think this is a promise from God. When you look through the Bible, when you read this verse in 2 Corinthians 12, I love it because it's like one little red spot in there where God says, my grace is sufficient for you. For my power is made perfect in weakness. So you guys close your eyes. I always say, bow your eyes and close your heads. No, don't do that. I think one of these things in our lives, we minimize, we discredit ourselves, we do all these things because there's those things in our lives where we just feel broken. We feel like we don't have the strength to face it, and we kind of just give into it. Where all of a sudden, that's just who we are. I'm never going to be anything better. And I want to pray for you guys today. If that's you, you know, I won't raise hands or anything like that. But if that's you, just open up your heart. I think so many times we've closed that off because we don't think, we're like Paul, hey man, I prayed for this. I prayed for this and nothing changed. You don't understand, Mark. I want this to go away and nothing has changed in it. God's saying, hey, you know what? It's not about the pain or the suffering to just leave. It's about my power and my grace and my love for you to fill that up. So, dear Jesus, thank you. God, you know that we are broken, we are flawed. And that we feel pressured on every side sometimes. Sometimes we don't feel we're good enough. Sometimes we feel like we are worthless. But God, really, deep down inside, you know the value you have placed upon us. You know the true beauty that we are, that you are making us into. So God, I just pray right now, Lord, for all of us in here who are feeling that way, God, that first and foremost, you allow that grace to fill in. Lord, we just pray for that grace from you, that love that goes beyond anything else, the love that you gave your own son so that we could have a connection with you, so that we can be restored to something even more beautiful than we were. Lord, I just pray for that grace to fill us up. And Lord, that grace to allow us to know that even in our brokenness, that you are creating something new. That the old is gone. And something more new and precious is in this place. That you didn't throw us out, but you made us whole. So God, I just pray right now for everybody in this room, Lord, that you take away that guilt of identifying in our brokenness or that weakness. You take away the guilt of even the fear of approaching you with it. And you allow us to embrace it. We love you. We thank you. So right now, guys, this is an opportunity for us to worship, to engage with God, to say, hey, this is where I'm at. We worship because, not just because we like to sing, me especially, I'm a horrible singer, but it's because it's an opportunity to sing our praises, to sing our concerns, to sing our love for God. So let's worship.